right now as I was coming up is like, what an amazing song right after that slow song, right? To jump in. God bless you guys. Welcome to Ignite Church. How are you guys doing today? If you are alive, you can clap, right? If you are breathing, you can put some of your hands together. Thank you very much. Hallelujah. It is a good day to be in the house of the Lord. You know, that song is actually a psalm that King David wrote. And before I jump into the word, I just want to read that psalm to you, because many times we feel like we're alone in this world, or that probably because we don't hear the voice of God as we would like to hear his voice, we feel like God is absent from our lives. But David, in one of his hardest times in his life, and going through trial after trial after trial, he pens down this psalm, and he wrote in Psalms 139, starting in verse 7, it says, "Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence?" He's questioning God. But then he responds, "If I go to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for the darkness is as light to you." How beautiful. How beautiful that whatever you are facing today, whether you feel that God is listening to you or ignoring you, whether you think that you are alone or not in life, be reminded by this verse. That wherever you go, wherever you find yourself today, God will go reach you and draw you near. Whether you are in the heavens or in the depths, meaning in the lowest of your life, even there, the Spirit of the Lord will reach out to you and bring you close to Him. Because that is the God we serve. He is a God that loves you. He is a God that wants to be with you. He longs for a relationship with you. And as David penned down this psalm, he was going through a rough time in his life. And he's questioning, where can I go? Because wherever I go, there you are. So just close your eyes 1 minute. We'll start the preaching, but just give God thanks. And you might be like, Pastor Eric, what do I give thanks for? Just thank him that you are alive today. That's more than enough to give thanks. You might be facing some hard times in your life, going through some challenges. You might be waiting on a prayer that to be answered, and you've been waiting for a long time. Just trust that He will come through. Thank you, God, for all you've done for us, Lord, because no matter where we go, no matter where we find ourselves, there you are. In the midst of the shadows, even in the midst of the valley, Lord, and wherever we are, even in the mountaintop, Father God, there you are, and there you draw us close. And for that, we are thankful. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Just wanted to share that with you before I jump into God's word. We have been going through this series called Fearless. But I want to remind you next week, say with me, next week. Say with me one more time, very strong, let the heavens hear it. Next week. There we go. Next week, we have our Spanish service, Ignite en Español. You do not want to miss that. You want to invite friends. Let's fill the house with Spanish speakers. It's going to bless your life. Pastor Armando Vidal is going to be bringing the word, and you do not want to miss that. So give the Lord a mighty hand clap praise. Sometimes I get inquiries from people that say, oh, we would like to go, but, you know, we don't speak English. Well, now's the time. Now's the time. So come, you know, come and receive from God's word as it's going to bless you. We've been in this series called Fearless, and we've been talking about how God could use anyone. For God does not look at your qualifications. God does not look at what you have in your bank account. God does not look at anything that you have on this earth other than your availability. If you are available to God, you do not need any other qualification. He just needs you to be available to him, and he will do amazing things for your life. We saw how God grabs a shepherd boy who's taking care of his father's sheep, and he has been forgotten probably and rejected by his own, but he has been chosen by God himself and has been anointed king of Israel. How God takes the life of a shepherd, one who probably feels that he's insignificant, that his life has no purpose, probably that he would never attain to anything, and he grabs that person and makes him one of the greatest kings Israel has ever known, King David. Israel had chosen for themselves a king in that time, and his name was Saul, and he was anointed to be king and led, but unfortunately he was led by his own understanding, by his own thoughts, by what he thought was right instead of obeying God, and because of that, God himself rejected him. We find in 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 8, Samuel said to him, this is the prophet speaking to Saul, "The Lord has torn the kingdom from Israel from you today and has given it to one of your neighbors, to one better than you." Although David was anointed king, we discovered that the office was taken. There was no vacancy. The office of being the king was currently being taken by Saul. And as we developed this series, as we went through week one and week two, we saw David's character on how David did not take things into his hand, but he stayed his course. He remained faithful to God. And as he is still taking care of his father's sheep while being anointed the king of Israel, he's still taking care of his father's sheep. One day his father says, "Hey, I need you to go take bread, some cheese, and some grain to your brothers because they're out at war." And as he's going out, it seems that God is about to give David the greatest opportunity of his life, disguised with a simple task. Do not take simple tasks for granted, because they might be the opportunity that God is sending your way, disguised for your breakthrough. God does not always send great things your way to give you alert. Hey, this is going to bring you breakthrough. Sometimes he allows the smallest little details to see if you're going to obey in those little details so that breakthrough will happen for your life. David was commissioned to be an Uber Eats driver, basically, and he's going out. His dad says, "I need you to take some bread, some cheese, and some grain, because guess what? You are a shepherd. Your brothers are warriors, so I need you to go take them some food." And as he's going out to take them food, because he's an obedient child, amen, hallelujah, I wish all children will be obedient, and us too, as he's going out taking some bread, some cheese, and some grain, he hears the voice of this giant. His name is Goliath, and he is challenging God's people. And from that day forth, God turns this Uber Eats driver into a mighty warrior that defeats Goliath with just a sling and a stone. A sling and a stone. But say with me, the office was still taken. Say with me, the office was still taken. Come on, say it one more time. The office was still taken. So now we find ourselves in the story that he has defeated Goliath. He has gone to war for Saul, and they're coming back now. And we find ourselves in 1 Samuel chapter 18. Verses 5 through 7, it says, "Whatever mission Saul sent him on, David was so successful that Saul gave him a high rank in the army." Let's pause here for a minute. What's going on? David was never a warrior before he fought Goliath. He had not known war. He was always a shepherd. If you recall, when he's about to fight Goliath, Saul tells him, "What do you think you're doing? You're not as strong as Goliath. You're just a little boy." And he recalls, "While I was out and a lion will come or a bear will come to try to take my sheep, I will go hunt it down, strike it down, and take the sheep from its mouth. And the same God that gave me victory with the lion and the bear will give me victory over this uncircumcised Philistine." But before that, before fighting Goliath, he was not a warrior. But now scripture says, whatever mission Saul sent him on, David was so successful that Saul gave him a high rank in the army. we're seeing how God is developing the life of David. You do not need to always understand everything to do something with your life. All you have to do is trust God that if God called you to something, he will make a way. Be available to him like David was, and God will start making you high in certain areas that you thought to yourself, I would never be in this area. I can never do this. I can never achieve this. This can never be done. And God says, for me, there is no never. For me, it's always. I could do anything, all time. He is Almighty God. So as we continue, this pleased all the troops and Saul's officers as well. In verse 6, when the men were returning home after David had killed the Philistine, the woman came out from all the towns of Israel to meet King Saul with singing and dancing, with joyful songs and with trembles and lyre. And they danced and they sang, Saul has slain his thousands and David his tens of thousands. Imagine that. A shepherd boy playing the harp, the lyre for the king, becomes now an Uber Eats driver, delivering some bread and cheese, slaying Goliath, and now being welcomed. And when they welcome him, what they say is, Saul has slain his thousands, and David his tens of thousands. Only God can promote you like that. Only God can promote you like that. There's nothing David did that could have promoted him like that. Mind you, he confronted a giant with a sling and a stone. And it wasn't the sling and the stone that killed Goliath. It was the power of God bringing him down. But David was, he made himself available to God. He believed God. He trusted in his word. He stood his ground knowing and fearing God and knowing what was right and wrong. Not even when the world turns against you, not even when the world is giving you its back, don't ever forget that God is still the one who has the final word. We move in a fast world. And sometimes you're working for a corporation or you're working on your career, you're working on your family, and everything is going fast. The other day I stopped to think for a minute. My son is 5 years old. He's about to turn 6. And I look back and I'm like, man, everything has gone by so fast. Boom, 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 boom. Quickly. When you're in the moment, it doesn't seem fast. But when you look back, you see how fast things have gone. But even in the fastness of this world, no one can be promoted the way David was in the current by the world standards. It has to be supernatural. And that's what our God does. But there was still a problem. Tell your neighbor, the office wasn't vacant. God started to lift up David in the eyes of Israel. And guess what? When God starts to lift you up, so will haters rise up. When God starts to promote you, so will haters rise up. And I wrote here, sadly, the first ones to rise up against you are in your inner circle. Sadly, the first ones to rise up against you whenever God is promoting you is those in your inner circle. The people that should believe in you, that should praise you and exalt you, are now jealous of your accolades. That's what happened with Saul. Didn't Saul lift up David and give him high ranks because he was successful? But something happened as they were coming in, and Saul heard the words, Saul has slain his thousands and David his tens of thousands. Be careful with the praises of men, because they could either make you think something that you are greater than something that you're not and make you fall immediately because of pride, or they could encourage you to keep on moving forward. There's two things that could happen with the praises. Be careful. Listen to this. In 1 Samuel chapter 18, we keep on in the narrative. In verse 8, it says, Saul was very angry. This refrain displeased him greatly. they have credited David with tens of thousands. He's probably crying, they've credited David with tens of thousands, he thought. And it says, but me, with only thousands? What more can he get but the kingdom? But the kingdom. And from that day on, Saul kept a close eye on David. Have you ever felt like someone's watching you? Have you ever felt like people that one day loved you, now they pretend to love you? No? Am I the only weirdo here? Have you ever felt like that? That as you are growing in life, as you are succeeding and God is promoting you, the people that once clapped for you, they still clap, but it's not with the same frequency anymore. They go like, woohoo, you got your promotion, so what? One day they're clapping, woo, go Eric, we believe in you, come on man, you can do it. When God starts lifting you up, go Eric, we believe in you, you suck. I hate you. They won't tell you, but their face will. Their attitude will. And these are the type of people that little by little, they become distant from your life. He kept a close eye on David. The next day, this is interesting, an evil spirit from God came forcefully on Saul. He was prophesying in his house. Be careful with the people that prophesy, because even evil spirits cook. No, I'm just kidding. He was prophesying in his house while David was playing the lyre as he usually did. And Saul had a spear in his hands, and he hurled it, saying to himself, I'll pin David to the wall. But David eluded him twice. He escaped him twice. And I love this next verse. Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with David, but had departed from Saul. So he sent David away from him and gave command over 1,000 men. And David led the troops in their campaigns. And in everything he did, he had great success because what? The Lord was with him. When Saul saw how successful he was afraid of him. But all Israel and Judah loved David because he led them in their campaigns. I want to pause there for a minute. I want to tell you, don't fear the haters in your life. Tell your neighbor, don't fear your haters. Haters are going to hate. Don't fear them. Don't fear them. The only hating that they have is not truly against you. It's the anointing of God upon your life. They hate the fact that God promotes you and God doesn't promote them. Now, God doesn't make exceptions of men or women. He doesn't say, oh, I'm going to bless her and I'm not going to bless him. No, but God looks for empty vessels, people that are available to him, people that are humble. And he says, this person I could lift up, this person I can't. This person I could lift up, this person I can't. And because God starts lifting up people and raising them up like he started raising up David because he had a humble heart, one that was committed, one that loved the Lord, Saul was already looking at him and angry at him. And he says, what else can he take from me but just the kingdom? So he was on to something. He was onto something. He realized that the Spirit of God was upon David, but yet had departed from him. Had departed from him. It's a very sad thing that once you serve the Lord, you fear that God is blessing someone because the Spirit is with them and not with you. It's a very scary thing. And we got to check ourselves if we become like Saul. Whenever someone looks down on you like Saul did on David for his stature and his experience, God will show up and show off his glory by elevating you like David above everyone else. Don't fear your haters. Don't worry about your haters. Tell your neighbor, you serve an almighty God. Come on, tell him strong. You serve an almighty God. This week I was reminded how we need to remind ourselves that we don't serve a God of stone or brass that doesn't speak back and can't do anything. We serve an almighty God that can do anything, and from him all things are possible. And you need to remind yourself sometimes. And guess what? Not only remind yourself, but remind your friends, remind your family, remind your neighbors, because they need the encouragement as well. Sometimes you are going through situations in life and you're questioning why, because God is working in it and through it to use you to bless other people's lives. But while you're going through it, you don't see it like that. David was going through it. He probably didn't see it like that. All he did, which is what we are encouraged to do today, is stay on course. Stay in your lane. Stay in your lane. You see, we find that, like ourselves probably today, David was in a holding pattern. And he stayed in his lane. He stayed moving forward. Promotion doesn't come by what you think you can do, but instead in your obedience to God's word. Promotion doesn't come in what you do. If that would have been the case, Saul would still be king. But he disobeyed God. David, on the other hand, stayed in his lane. Don't worry about the person next to you. Don't look how fast they're going. You stay on course. You keep moving forward. David didn't look at Saul and say, "Hey, Saul, that crown belongs to me. I'm anointed, you're not. That office belongs to me. Give it to me now." No. He stayed on course. Jesus told his disciples, when we're talking about how God could do great things and do greater things, he told his disciples, "Greater things you will do in my name." How many believe that we're living in times today that we need to be reminded more and more of God's word? We need to be reminded and speak it over our lives, because in the midst of all these haters, some of them will try to misguide you or mislead you to believe that they are for you, but instead they're totally plotting against you. Saul, if you continue reading the chapter, Saul now says, "I got to get rid of David. I got to get rid of him because everybody loves him. He's good at everything he does because the Spirit of God is with him. He's successful. I got to get rid of him, because if I don't, he'll take the kingdom from me." Whenever someone feels threatened by you, it's because they are not confident in who they are. Whenever someone feels threatened because the anointing of God is upon your life, it's because they fear that God has left them. So Saul's like, "I got to get rid of him." So what does he do? He starts devising this plan. What was the thing that they were going to give David if he would overcome Goliath? Well, one of the things was that he would marry the king's daughter. And so what happens is, when David fought Goliath, and this was one of the rewards, Saul, instead of giving his daughter to David, he gives it to someone else. And he thinks to himself, "Well, probably if I cause some pain, some anger into David's heart, he'll probably act rebellious, and probably he'll start looking bad in the eyes of Israel. Probably God will no longer be with him." So what does he do? He takes from him what rightfully belongs to him. How many of you have ever been in a situation that something's been taken from you that rightfully belongs to you? Raise your hand. How does it feel? How does it feel within you? Probably you got crazy and you started screaming and you started cursing and started going all over the place. But David didn't. David stayed humble. Man, when I read David, I wish I was like David. He has such an amazing character, such an amazing heart. He wasn't perfect. Because we know how the story goes on. He murdered. He adultered. But his character, as he followed God, was admirable in the way how he lived. So David remained humble and in his lane. And in 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 18, he tells Saul, but David said to Saul, who am I? And what is my family or my clan in Israel that I should become the king's son-in-law? He kind of like said, hey, I come from humble beginnings. I don't know how to take this. I don't know how to have a protocol of being your son-in-law. I don't know what it means to live in a palace. And who am I? Who are my people? See, if we were to have that attitude, that humble attitude, life would be completely different. Instead, we live in a generation that believes that everything belongs to them. That they deserve everything. And what's happened in the Church of Jesus Christ is that we've become these bratty Christians. Now, nobody says amen, but I'll say it amen for everyone in the house. Christians today are brats. Yes, you. Don't look at me with that face. Me too. We're brats. We act like we deserve everything. We act like if it doesn't go our way, what happens? We act foolishly. And what we do is give the name of the Lord a bad name. We give the church a bad name. Why? Because it belongs to me. When promotion that you waited for was given to someone else, instead of you being happy for that person, you turn down on that person. You look down on that person. You curse that person. So what type of attitude, Christ-like attitude, do you have? When a friend is blessed in an area that you've been praying for your own, you're not happy for them. We're bratty. We're bratty. Can I get a brat to say amen? Thank you, brats. When you feel that you're qualified more than others, yet you have not been chosen, you act bratty. The enemy, guess what, church? The enemy is working overtime. He's working overtime to make us lose our cool when things don't go our way. He did with Saul. He said, let me take away what belongs to David. Let's see how he'll act. Probably he'll act rebellious. Probably he'll start destroying things. Probably he'll start looking dumb in front of Israel. And Israel will no longer sing, David has slain his tens of thousands. It all started because of that little phrase. It all started because of jealousy. Because they looked upon David and said, wow, David, you've killed tens of thousands. And, well, Saul, you killed 1,000. It all started because of what people said. Be careful, because many times the issues that you face in life is because of what people said. No? It all starts because so-and-so said this. So-and-so did that. So-and-so looked at me like that. And I don't know why I'm moving my hand like this, but let me put it down. So-and-so, be careful. Because if you are driven by what people say about you, then you truly don't have a real relationship with God. Because your life should be based on what God says about you and not what men and women say about you. David kept on his course. He stayed in his lane. Many people are insecure like Saul. We read Saul was very angry. This refrain displeased him greatly. They have credited David with tens of thousands, he thought, but me only 1,000? What more can he get but the kingdom? See, David was fearless. How many fearless people we have in the house today? Only one person. Can I get a fearless shout? How many fearless people we have in the house today? No. How many fearless people we have in the house today? Come on, make a shout. He was fearless. So when Saul saw that he could not get David to act foolish, what does he do? He puts together another plan. See, the enemy doesn't sleep. That's why the Bible says, resist the devil and he will flee. Now, it doesn't say that he'll stop bugging you. It just says he will flee. which makes me understand that he'll flee for a moment and he'll come back again to see, and he'll put pressure and pressure to see how you're going to act, if you're going to give in or you're going to resist. So Saul finds out that he has another daughter that is in love with David. He says, this is the greatest opportunity. I'll hand that daughter on to David, and then I'll work with her to destroy him. I'll give him my daughter. I'll eat her ear. I'll tell her, this is what you're going to do with him. You're going to make him do this, that, 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 and we'll get rid of him. So I don't have to fear David anymore. So what does he do? He tells his people to go speak to David and say, hey, David, guess what? Saul's daughter is in love with you. She's a beauty. She is a hottie hottie. She has it all. And guess what? She's on to you. Do you want her? The king will give it to you. So David turns it down again. David was not concerned with that. And so they go back to Saul and say, hey, Saul, David says that, who is he? Same excuse he gave you last time. Who is he? You know, he's humble. His family has a humble beginning. Like, really? Like, so Saul remembers something. David is a man of honor. David is a man after God's own heart. And so he sends David on a quest. But before he sends him on a quest, he kind of he throws in this little bribe or thing to make him feel like, well, if he does this, he's going to get his daughter. So he tells David, hey, David, 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 25. So Saul replies, say to David, the king wants no other price for the bride. And this is about to get a little gruesome. Other than 100 Philistines foreskins to take revenge on his enemies. Saul's plan was to have David fall by the hands of the Philistine. When the attendants told David these things, guess what? He was pleased to become the king's son-in-law. Basically, he said, you know what? Okay, I'm going to do God's will. I'm going to destroy the enemy. It makes sense to now become the king's son-in-law. So before the allotted time elapsed, listen to this. David took his men and went out and killed 200 Philistines and brought back their foreskins. Nasty. They counted all of a full number to the king so that David might become the king's son-in-law. Then Saul gave him his daughter Michal in marriage. When Saul realized that the Lord was with David and that his daughter Michal loved David, Saul became still more afraid of him, and he remained his enemy the rest of his days. 100 foreskins. Now, if you don't know what that is, just Google it. I'm not going to tell you. No, I'm just kidding. Don't Google it. Yeah, don't Google it. Sorry. That's a bad one. 100 foreskins. Saul is trying to get rid of the enemy, but at the same time, he's trying to get rid of his enemy, which is David. And he's like, hey, David, the price I want from my daughter is that you go and kill 100 Philistines and bring me back their 100 foreskins to show me proof that you did it. David found it pleasing. Not knowing why, but he found it pleasing. He says, sure. So he goes out. He not only kills 100, he kills 200. And bring back their foreskins. Now imagine, I thought that the lowest job a servant had in a kingdom was washing people's feet. I think the lowest job was counting 200 foreskins. Now back then, they probably didn't have, what are they called, N95 masks? You know, so no masks, no gloves, and they're counting 200 men's foreskins. And they counted them one by one. How pleasing of a job. David did not want anything given to him. His attitude was, let me work for it. So basically, don't sit on your lazy behind expecting for everything to move in your favor. Get up and do something. Too many Christians today sit back. Only because you receive the anointing doesn't mean that you don't have to do something with it. Get moving. Do something with the anointing of God upon your life. See how God moves in your life. You might be waiting for a breakthrough, but until you get up and do something, you might not see anything. And the question is, while you are waiting, what are you doing? What are you doing? See, the enemy will deceive you and will try to make you fail and even kill you. But wake up. You are not only a shepherd. I wrote here, you are not only a shepherd. You are not only anointed. You are not just any Uber Eats driver. You are not any warrior for God's kingdom. You are God's warrior, and he will give you victory over everything if you have that attitude. David knew that he didn't deserve the king's daughter. He said it. Who am I? Who's my people? Who's my clan that I should become the king's son-in-law? But when the opportunity was given to him, he saw an opportunity not for his gain, but for God's kingdom's gain, to destroy the enemies of God. You see, the battle that you face, okay, the battle you face is not against those that hate you. It's not the person at work. It's not the person you sleep in the same bed with. It's not your mom and dad. The battle is not against the people that hate you. The battle is not against those people that make your life a living hell. It might seem like it is. But we're reminded by the Apostle Paul in the book of Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. For our struggle is not against flesh. It's not against blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. And he gives us this encouragement, this challenge. In verse 13, he says, therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after that, you have done everything to stand. See, many of us don't do anything. We're these bratty Christians. We deserve everything. Well, God says his favor is upon my life. Yes, his favor is something that is unmerited. You don't do anything for God's favor. You don't earn God's favor. He just gives you his favor. The question is, what are you going to do with it? Because many times in scripture, we see that people that were blessed, that didn't do anything with the blessing was taken from them. Some of us have been waiting on God, like David has been waiting for that throne, for that kingdom that was promised to him when he was 15 years old. Guess what? He didn't see the kingdom until he was almost 30 years old, 15 years later. And some of us have been praying for only a week, and we're going desperate because we have not seen God answered our prayer. Think about 15 years in the making. And it wasn't 15 easy years. It wasn't 15 years where he sat on the couch, he turned on Netflix, and he was watching TV shows and just saying, well, one day, one day, one day. No, it was 15 years being persecuted by Saul himself, one who one day loved him but became his enemy the next day. It was 15 years hiding in caves, hiding for his life. 15 years struggling many times, writing down psalms that he wished his life would be taken from him, but yet he praise the Lord because God still had a purpose with him. It was 15 years of struggle. It was 15 years of tears, of crying, and probably screaming out to God in the midst of a wilderness, in the midst of darkness. That's why he wrote, the Lord is my shepherd. What shall I want? Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for your rod and staff will guide me. 15 years where he says, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I go from your presence? If I was to make my bed in heaven, there you are. If I was to make my bed in hell, basically, there you are. 15 years. He wasn't a bratty Christian. I told someone this week, If you don't have, it's because you don't ask. Sometimes we think that, well, God knows my problem, so why even talk to him? That's like telling your spouse, he knows I feel bad, but why should I tell him how I, you know, tell him the details? Would you please stand with me, dear? God grabbed and chose a shepherd boy, young. It says that he was young, he was handsome, but he was a shepherd. Calls him out. He was the youngest of eight boys. Crazy household. When Samuel comes to the house to anoint the king, he was not even invited. And when they asked his dad, Jesse, hey, Jesse, do you have another son? Because these seven are not it. Did we miss someone? He's like, oh, yeah, you know, I forgot. There's one back there taking care of the sheep. But do you really need him? Yes, because we will not sit down until he comes in. You probably feel forgotten or abandoned, or you feel like, you know, God himself has put you aside. He's forgotten about your prayers. Sometimes we feel like that. If we're honest, sometimes we feel like, man, I have prayed so much, I've done so much, and I really haven't seen so much. I know what that feels like. Only because I'm standing here with a microphone doesn't make me greater than you. Doesn't make me go through less things than you. While we're here on earth, Jesus said, you will go through trials. You will go through hardships. But he said, take heart. Take heart. I've overcome this world. As David waited on God, he went from being a shepherd boy, anointed as king. The office was taken. He had multiple times the opportunity to take the kingdom by force. But he didn't. He didn't. He waited on God. As you read the life of David, which unfortunately we don't have the time right now to go through, you will find that there was at least two opportunities that he could have gotten rid of Saul. But he said, who am I to touch the anointed one of the Lord? Don't worry about who's occupying the office you've been called to sit in. When your time comes, that office will be given to you. Don't worry if God is blessing other people. Instead, be joyful. Rejoice in other people's victories. Because the day that you have yours, you want them also to rejoice with you. Don't worry about the people that are hating on you all the time because God is promoting you. If anything, pray for them. Pray for them. So that God will show them that it's not what you've done. It's not that you deserve anything. It's because he's good. And he wants to do the same with them. Church, don't worry about what the world is saying, what the people are speaking. Stay in your lane. Remind yourself that God has anointed you, that God has chosen you, that he's brought you out of the darkness into his glorious light. He has made you a new creation in Christ Jesus. The old has passed, the new has come. Remind yourself that even you are facing Goliath, it's not by your own strength, but it is by the Spirit of the Lord that you will see Goliath fall down and you will chop his head off. Remind yourself that the same God that gave you victory in the wilderness against the lion and the bear will be the same God that will give you victory in the valley of the battle with the greatest giant that you face. And yes, you will be promoted, but may your eyes not be fixed on your promotion. May your eyes be fixed on the author and finisher of your faith, whose name is Jesus Christ. Because everything in this world will pass. That promotion one day could be taken from you. Things happen in this world. We saw that 3 years ago. 1 million layoffs, 1 million demotions. Many people are still not even back to work. Anything could happen. But the promotion I'm talking about is not one of temporary satisfaction. It's one that comes from God. Don't worry about the people that hate you. Keep your eyes fixed on Christ. Moving forward, stay in your lane. Would you lift up your hands to heaven? Probably today you feel like this heaviness upon you. You know, David, the Bible says that many times he was fleeing from Saul. Mind you, he was good to Saul. He didn't do anything against Saul, not even once. He was best of friends with Jonathan, who was Saul's son. The Bible says that they were one in spirit. I've never seen anywhere in scripture other than that where it speaks about one in spirit with someone as a friend, as Jonathan and David were friends. And yet Saul hated David. I could only imagine the pressure, the questions, the tiredness, the weariness many times that David faced. But David did not let that hold him back from staying in his lane. He knew God had a purpose with him. And today I'm reminding you, God still has a purpose with your life. God has not given up on you. He may seem silent. Sometimes the best things he does is when it's silent, because he's working behind the scenes. He may feel that he's absent. He's not. He's present. Draw near to God. James says, draw near to God and God will draw near to you. Just lift up your hands to heaven. God, I pray for everyone in this house today. And those who are watching online or watch later or hear this message. God, I believe that you're still looking for people like David. People that are out there in the field, they probably just, they're doing something and they feel like, well, this is all I'm going to do in my life. And you're about to show them that with you, anything is possible as long as we are available to you, God. Help us stay humble. Help us stay humble, not become bratty Christians. Help us realize, Lord, that we don't deserve anything. If anything, we deserve is death because of our sin. We don't deserve anything. But help us, Father God, as we wait on you, trust in you, obey you, obey you. Because, Lord, I know that as we obey you, Lord, you do with us like you did with David. You could promote us from being a shepherd to a king in an instant. For you, nothing is impossible. Whatever battles we are facing today, Lord, give us the courage. Help us gain the courage within, Lord. May our faith be strengthened, Lord, to be able to stand against those giants, God. Lord, knowing that it's not by the weapon that we have in our hands, it is through your spirit, because you told us, Lord, that our battle is not against flesh and blood, Lord, but against principalities, against governors of darkness in the heavenly realms, Lord. Help us use the full armor of God. Put it on, Lord, so we could be able to stand firm in the days of evil. And we know, God, we are living in very evil days, God. Help us, Lord, stand firm when the whole world is against us. Help us stand firm when those in our most inner circle, Lord, have become our haters. Help us stand firm, Father God, when it seems that, Lord, you are absent and you're silent in our lives. Help us stand firm upon your word, because we know that in due time, things will turn around, God, and we will see the victory, not only through our spirit, but see it become alive in our lives, God. And we will celebrate, we will exalt you, God, and we will declare that with you, all things are possible. Thank you, God. Thank you that you still give us a chance. Thank you that you still love us. That no matter where we come from, no matter what we have done, no matter what our past looks like, you still have an amazing, bright future for our lives through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.